Hi, I'm Sister Joan Marie Stelman, and I'm going to be talking about Benedictine history, which is part two of our governance formation module. Benedictine monasticism has roots in both Jewish and Christian traditions. It combines some of the ascetic practices of the hermit monks. So there were these desert fathers and mothers that were living in the area around Palestine, but it tempers that with a more moderate kind of communal life. So it's known for that moderation compared to some of the extreme expressions of monasticism that were around earlier. It's a response to the call to live as followers of Christ. So sometimes I think we're tempted to just see Benedictine philosophy as something separate from that, but it's really rooted in Christian, in following Christ. It's rooted in scripture, and it's informed by our history of scholarship, our long history of scholarship, and our lived experience over the centuries. A few things about Saint Benedict to start with. This image of Saint Benedict is an icon that was done by Sister Mary Charles Magoo. He's the founder of our order, hence Benedictines. He lived from about 480 to 540. Saint Scholastica was actually his sister. So she was not only a sister in terms of being a nun, but his blood sister. This icon is also one that was painted by Sister Mary Charles, and it is in our chapel that we share with the college. In about 530, he wrote something called The Rule of Saint Benedict. That's an extremely misleading title, because if I didn't know what rule meant, I would have no idea. But in Latin, the word for rule is regula. So it's a lot of little regulations that help us to live well together in community. There's not a lot that we know about Saint Benedict. All that we know comes from a book called The Dialogues of Gregory the Great, book two of the Dialogues. And we know that when he was a young man, he was intended to go to school in Rome, as did most of the people of his class. But he was increasingly disgusted with some of the immorality that he saw, and so he decided to retreat and become a hermit in this cave at Subiaco. And lest you think that this is a really horrible thing, this is what Subiaco looks like. It's really quite beautiful. But eventually, people came to know that he was there and regarded him as a holy man, and so they asked him to leave the cave, and he left and embraced communal life. In about 529, he founded the Abbey of Monte Cassino. In the upper left, you see what the abbey looks like today. It was completely rebuilt after the war, but you can see the picture of the devastation that happened during the bombing. So how did Benedictine monasticism become the standard in all of Western Christendom and last for over 1,500 years? In the first place, it began to spread kind of slowly in Italy and in some places in Europe through the rule and by evangelization. But it became standard because of the protection of royalty. So in the continental part of Europe, Charlemagne mandated that that was the only rule that was going to be used. And in England, the English rulers also did the same thing. So there's Charlemagne had a pretty good opinion of himself. He's there with being crowned from heaven with Gregory the Great at his side. So it spread even further after the Cistercians came to be in the 11th century. That's Trappist, St. Bernard of Clairvaux, you might know. And then the influence of the popes helped Benedictinism to spread even farther, because the popes used the Benedictine monks and the Cistercian monks to help Christianize all of Europe. So other rules had died out, partly because they were too extreme. They didn't have the same kind of adaptability and wisdom that the rule did. So some of the threats that happened to the growth and continuance of Benedictine monasticism in the Middle Ages were that in the 12th and 13th centuries, new orders began to spring up. Prior to that, you know, it was pretty much monasticism, but then the Franciscans, Dominicans, and other mendicant orders came to be, and they were drawing vocations to them. Also, there were waves of disasters in the late Middle Ages, plague, waves of plague that came through, series of wars like the Hundred Years' War and the 30 Years' War. And then in the 16th century comes the Reformation. So there were houses that were taken over, places that were destroyed, especially in England. Cromwell completely destroyed a lot of the abbeys. And then in the French Revolution came along in the 18th century, and in France that caused a lot of the monasteries that were left in France to be destroyed. And then if things hadn't been worse, Napoleon came along, and whatever was left that in the areas that Napoleon conquered, he dismantled. So he made laws that it was against the law to be a monk or a nun. So throughout that kind of thousand-year period of time, actually a little bit more than that, in Europe, it was said that we brought the cross, Christianity, so we helped to Christianize Europe, the book, because of the legacy of learning and the arts that the monks and nuns had and the schools that they ran, and the plow. And you might not think about the plow, but the Benedictines and the Cistercians developed really good agricultural practices that spread as well. So in 1964, Pope Paul VI named St. Benedict the patron of all Europe. Now, our particular house comes from the German branch of Benedictines that came to the United States, and the sisters came from the Abbey of St. Walburga in Eichstätt. So there's a picture there of the abbey and a tapestry of St. Walburga from the abbey. Now, they were part of the territory that had been conquered by Napoleon. They were doing all right up until then, but in 1806, he forced the community to be secularized. So the nuns lost all of their property. They were allowed to stay in the abbey, but they couldn't have any new members come at all, and they were supposed to just stay there till they all died. By the time of Napoleon's death, there were still 13 sisters that survived that whole process. And luckily, King Ludwig of Bavaria wanted to reinstate and reestablish the monasteries. So here he is in his fancy dress. That's his fanciest. So the abbeys were restored, and St. Walburga's was actually, the formal date of restoration was 1835. The sisters had to choose some kind of work that they were going to do, and they decided that they would run a school and teach girls. Coming to America was a whole nother thing. Boniface Wimmer really was the person that kind of started all of that. He was a monk at at Metten Abbey, which is kind of the counterpart, the men's counterpart of St. Walburga's. And he really wanted to go to the New World and help the German immigrants. So he was allowed to go. He founded St. Vincent's Arch Abbey in Latrobe in Pennsylvania in 1830. And then he came back because he knew he needed help. And it's always been the case that when the bishops or the abbots need help with education or with healthcare, that they come to ask the nuns for that. So he came back to recruit people, and Mother Benedicta Reap agreed to go back with him, and she was allowed to go back with two other sisters. They came in 1852. They landed on July 4th in New York. She was only 27 years old at the time. Coming to Minnesota was another thing that was really dear to her heart. She wanted to expand the influence of the Benedictine sisters and monks, and she knew about St. John's, and so she wanted to form a community, a women's community, in St. Cloud. She was not allowed to go at that time because there were some things that she was dealing with in Pennsylvania, but six sisters left in 1857. First, they came to St. Cloud before they moved to St. Joseph, where they are now. She actually came after they did in 1858, and she died in 1862 of tuberculosis at the age of 37. So she was at St. Benedict's at the time that that happened, and her grave is there, and that's something that we all cherish. Mother Scholastica Kirst is actually the founder of our community. She was born in Germany in 1847. Her parents were pretty wealthy. They lived in St. Paul. She wanted to become a nun, so she entered what was called St. Gertrude's Convent in Shakopee. You might recognize that name because of St. Gertrude's. And that was in 1862. But she wasn't there for very long before St. Gertrude's had to be closed. They couldn't make a go of it financially. So she transferred to St. Ben's in 1877, and in only 3 years, she became the prioress. She was the prioress of St. Ben's from 1880 to 1889, and she came to Duluth at the invitation of Bishop James McGulrick. So when Bishop McGulrick got here, before Duluth was even a diocese, and he saw the great need for schools and for health care, he asked her to come and take a look and see what the sisters could do. She began to found schools here in 1881, and she founded St. Mary's in 1888. So both of those things happened before the community was even officially founded, and our founding date dates to 1892, after she was no longer prioress. So when the sisters came, we wanted to find a home. There wasn't any place to live at first, so we rented a part of the newly built Munger Terrace. The bishop had one half of the building, and the sisters had the other half and ran a school out of it. And then we were able to complete our own building in 1895. Now, the funny part about that is originally the place where St. Mary's is in Duluth is where our mother house was supposed to be. But Bishop McGulrick said, wouldn't that be a better place for the hospital? The hospital was out in the West End. And he persuaded her to give that land for the hospital, and we found another space to start a building there. But that was our first home that we owned. So that's what ended up on the space where our mother house is, New St. Mary's, which was opened in 1898. And you can see how the hospital grew so quickly when you think about how the population was growing and the danger of some of the occupations that were here. There was a lot of need for health care. But she also had a vision beyond just staying downtown in Duluth. And she thought about building a house of higher education, something that would be like the abbeys in Europe were. And so the Daisy Farm came to her attention. She purchased the first 80 acres of that in 1899. An additional 80 acres were purchased in 1907. And by 1909, half of Tower Hall was built. The new Villa Sancta Scholastica Academy was opened. And the sisters moved up the hill. She didn't live to see this because she died in 1911, but in 1912, the College of St. Scholastica was founded. And here's what the college looked like for our centennial photograph. I'm not going to go into a lot of the history about all the different institutions, because in the second volume of our formation modules, you're going to hear from each of the individual mission leaders who are going to talk a lot more in depth about those kinds of foundations. In 1980, we opened the Benedictine Health Center. So now the sisters, the monastery was in between the college and the Benedictine Health Center. Wasn't the first time we were in long-term care, however, because we ran St. Anne's out of the old hospital building in the West End and then later where it was now. So this was not our first foray into long-term care, but it was the first time we had a health care facility on the campus. And in 1985, the Benedictine Health System was formed by the sisters to try to help us administer all of the varied health care facilities that we had. Thank you so much for listening. You'll find a lot more information in your packets, so that if you want to find out more about the history of the sisters or the history of Benedictines, there's a lot of different reading that you can do, different places to go. If you have any questions, you can always ask us. Thank you so much.